Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
The next item on the agenda is citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Would you please come forward? David Joliker, who's been our intern this summer.
Thank you. David Joliker, 481 Mitchell Road here in Cape Elizabeth. I'm a 12-year resident altogether of this community. For those of you in the community who don't know who I am, other than my name, obviously, at this point, I'm a graduate student at the University of Maine, where I'm earning a master's degree in public administration. And the reason why I wanted to speak to you tonight is because I wanted to publicly thank all of you, the council, namely, and especially the town manager, Michael McGovern, for allowing me to serve a 6-credit municipal internship here at the town hall this summer. Basically, those 6 credits will go towards total credits required of the master's degree at University of Maine. And I think that one of the reasons why I want to talk to the public about this is because I think it's very important that the community knows that this administration takes an active role in the process of higher education, because I think it's very important. It's an indicator of so many other good things about this administration. Basically, what it boiled down to was a sharing of knowledge and information. And I think that when you have that, you just can't lose. I've learned a lot this summer. It's been an eye-opening experience for sure. But I also want to thank Mr. McGovern for his professionalism and all of his respect that he's given me this summer. It's been fantastic. I also want to thank the entire staff at the town hall. There really isn't anybody who wasn't helpful this summer in teaching me a little bit about something. Namely, I want to thank Barbara Ray, who was fantastic. It's Mike McGovern's assistant, administrative assistant. I want to thank Debbie Lane, the town clerk. Thank you for everything. And there's other people, too. I want to thank the assessor, Jerry Daigle, and Ernie McVain, who's the code enforcement officer. This summer, these two gentlemen took me out on the field several times, basically to teach me a little bit about what they do. And essentially, it's just going to give me that much more of a leg up if I'm lucky enough to manage my own community someday. I also want to thank Maureen O'Mara, who is the town planner. She also spent some time teaching me a little bit about what it is to be a planner. That's quite a job, too, I found. And all, of course, all the ladies at the front desk, they were all very helpful, too. I could stand here all night, basically, and thank everybody, because it's been a great experience. I do want to thank Mr. Kepris and Mr. McGovern again, because he really did treat me like a professional and treated me with respect. And it's just been a great experience. And I thank all of you, the counselors, as well. Thank you.
Thank you, and we wish you good luck in completion of your graduate studies.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else?
I wanted to respond to David.
Oh, surely.
If I may. I also wanted to say thank you very much for the invaluable information that you have researched and provided for several of the committees that are meeting outside of this seated town council, and we all appreciate that as well. Thank you. You earned those credits, I'm sure.
Madam Chair.
Yes, Mr. Linnell.
Yeah, I'd also like to say thanks to David. The conversations I had with him, I think he certainly got the most out of the experience, and I'm kind of sorry to see you go. Come on back.
Anyone else? If not, we'll move on to reports and correspondence.
Madam Chairman.
Councilor Chappell.
The Regional Waste Services had their annual meeting July the 20th. Manager McGovern, Bill Jordan, and I attended. Pleased to report that we ended up the fiscal year June 30th, 1995, in the black. You remember I've been telling you since January our problems with money and our problems with tipping fees, and it right down to the last month, and we finally came out with around $34,000 in the black instead of being in the red for the year, which I thought was great. I was elected again to the executive committee for this next year and appointed to the finance committee, so we'll be bringing reports back to you monthly. August the 10th, we had an executive committee meeting. That's last Thursday. on privatization. It's gone through the executive committee. I won't tell you how it's going to work till it goes through the board meeting, which we're going to hold this Thursday. Along with that, I brought back a present for the chairman or chairperson of the committee. I couldn't get anything smaller than an extra large.
So extra large.
I understand they like to wear them long. Is that right? Way down? Good. We got it. There you are.
Oh, thank you. Fluorescent pink. You'll see me in the dark. Thank you, Mr. Chapel. That concludes your presentation? Okay. Any other reports and correspondence? Councilor Reed.
Yes, Madam Chairman, I'd like to report that the Pedals and Pedestrian Committee, known as the P2 Committee, meets twice a month, and our next meeting is August 24th at 7:15 in the Town Hall. These meetings are all public. We have identified bikeways around town, and we're looking at six of them at the next meeting. They are not Shore Road or Two Lights Road. So I just wanted to let the public know we are meeting twice a month. The process is continuing, and all meetings are public.
Thank you. Anyone else? Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. On Wednesday, July 19th, I attended the monthly meeting of the Greater Portland Council of Governments Executive Committee. Our speaker that evening was Lucian Goslin, who is from the Maine Development Foundation. What he talked to us about was the report of the Maine Economic Growth Council, and they have very nicely done, both graphically and content-wise, report. What impressed me a lot with this was that the emphasis is on the it's on the outcomes. It's not what, how much work you do, but how important or how significant the work is. And I think that's something that I intend to take, you know, under advisement and start looking at that from the municipal side. The tongue's not going to work tonight as well. But it was a very interesting presentation. I do have the materials that were passed out that night. If any other councillor wants to look at them, it was well done.
Thank you. Anyone else? Mr. McGovern, do you have some comments you wanted to make?
Yes, just very briefly. First, I also want to thank Dave Joliker for the excellent job he's done this summer. Really been enjoyable working with him. There's been a number of questions about what's going on at Lyons Field. Just briefly update everyone. We have just fixed the water line going into Lyons Field. In the near term, the road will be paved up to as far as the Little League field. That it's something that really should reduce the dust there quite a bit, as well as the mud as folks go in there in the springtime. So it should be a major improvement. We also have a new telephone system in many of our municipal offices, and I want to give a very, very special thank you to Deborah Lane, who has not only worked in this during the days, but also the evenings and the weekends to make sure that the system is up and running and continues to watch it very closely, and it looks like we'll have an excellent phone system that will really help to serve the citizens better in the months ahead. In the short term, particularly with some of the untrained operators, one I know in particular, very, very well, there may be a few problems, but by the end of this week, everything should be running perfectly, and the operators, including those that need more training, myself personally, should have it working just fine. So I really want to thank Deborah for all her hard work on that, as well as the committee that has been working with her on that. Thank you.
Anyone else? I would like to call attention to a very special exhibit that is just open today at Battery 201 called Permanence of Memory. It is recollections, audio tapes and interviews of veterans of World War II, particularly the war in the Pacific, the 50th anniversary of that finalization of the war. One of the star interviewees is our own Councillor Irving Chapel, who was very active in the Pacific Theater. Mr. McGovern and I attended the opening ceremonies this afternoon, and I invite you all to attend. It's very worthwhile. And in keeping with 50th anniversary celebrations, for those of you who don't know, our own counselor, William Jordan, and his lovely wife, Ruth, just celebrated 50 years of wedded bliss. Now, on the more serious note, the town council had a workshop, and we have set our goals for this coming year. Number one is to take a proactive role in fostering a community-wide approach to dealing with substance abuse issues. Councilors Linnell and McGinty will sort of take that issue under their wing and guide it through the process. To identify plan for community recreational needs, Councilor Chapel and I will guide that one. As you know, we're already working on Little League fields. Develop a process for capital budgeting and strategic long-range planning. Councilor Chapel and Councilor Reed will be responsible for that. To revamp the budget process and the format, Councilors Jordan and McLaughlin. Expand the forums for public communication, Councilors Reed and McLaughlin. They're not in any particular order of priority. We are going to work as diligently as possible to have something to show for our attempts by the end of the year. And now it gives me great pleasure to make a special town council resolution to the girls' 9 and 10-year-old State of Maine softball champions with their coaches, Mark Miller, and I guess Ellen Knight is not here.
Yes,
if you would like to come forward, Mr. Miller, and just have your girl, and have the girls who are here sort of circle around us. Make a semicircle so you can be seen by the camera, and I'll read this to you. So some over here, and some over here. And they're wearing, of course, their championship uniforms. Whereas the Cape Elizabeth girls, 9 and 10-year-old, recently won the Maine State Softball Championship, and whereas the girls had a season marked with perfection as every game was a victory, and whereas attainment of the championship finish is indicative of dedication to practice, good athletic skills, and an aspiration for continued achievement, and whereas the Cape Elizabeth Town Council and all the citizens of Cape Elizabeth wish to express our pride in the girls' softball team for earning this distinction. Now, therefore, be resolved by the Cape Elizabeth Town Council that we hereby congratulate and honor the girls' softball team on their first place finish, and we thank them for representing our community so well. Dated 14th day of August in the year of 1995 at Cape Elizabeth, Maine, and signed by all the town councilors. Congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It was a real honor to coach this team. As I said a couple times before, I coached the All-Star team last year, and we played very well. 7 of the 12 that were on the team played last year, and we played 2 games, and we went out in 2 games, but I said we'd be back next year with lots of experience. And most of these girls played in the major leagues this year, and they did just an outstanding job. And the first 2 weeks of practice, I didn't know too much, because I tell you, I won't be too political here, but we had a hard time finding a practice field. We got kicked off 3 different times of soccer fields. When we finally were able to get a practice field, the girls really started to pull together. And they were just outstanding as far as sportsmanship, as far as dedication. And on the field, they were tremendous, showed really good ability to learn. Each game, they improved. And I was just very, very pleased. Ellen Knight is not here this evening, and she was just outstanding as assistant coach, and she was able to be there one of the games when I wasn't there, and Kathy Gork, who covered for me, I was on a business trip, and they won the 6 and 10-year-old, they won the first championship, the regionals, when I wasn't there, and I said, we'll be back for the states, and we were able to be there. So thank you very much, and especially, Mr. McGovern, thank you very much for setting this up. I really appreciate it. Let me just say the 12 names of the team members, and there's five that aren't here. McKinley Donahue, McKinley, Christina Foley, Jen Fowler is not here tonight, Kate Cohegan, Diana Getchell, Allie Knight is not here tonight, Kate Martin, Heidi Millar, Margie Reed, Andrea Skillings, Nikki Tarbox is not here tonight, and Katie Wentworth is not here tonight. Thank you very much, and these girls will be moving on to 11 and 12-year-olds, and let's hope we do well next year. Thank you very much.
Next, we move on to the minutes of meeting number 2 of 95-96.
Madam Chairman, before you move on, I'd just like to respond to the applause that I received, and I would just like to add a comment that I appreciate it, but also back in the years, especially the year we bought the first unit for the rescue unit and kind of rebuild the inside and what have you, my wife used to say quite often, why don't you take your bed up the corner?
Oh. On to the meeting minutes of our July 10th, 1995. Any comments?
Move approval.
Madam Chairman?
Yes, Councilor Reed.
There's a change that I'd like to make in my motion for item number 28. I believe it should include a reference to the fact that Councilor McGinty added language to include as a condition the terms of the June 29, 1995 letter from the Portland Water District General Manager David Jealous as a condition of the motion. Is that correct, Councilor McGinty?
Yes, that's correct.
Is that a second?
Yes.
To amend?
Second to amend.
Any other changes? Councilor Now.
Yes, thank you, Madam Chairman. Under reports and correspondence, I already spoke to the town clerk about this. When it says that Councilor Linnell missed the employee picnic. It was actually the opposite. I made the employee picnic because I was flipping burgers with our distinguished Councilor Chappell, and I passed up an invitation to speak to the President's Council on Sustainable Development. Knowing I had that commitment to flip burgers for the employees, so I spoke to the clerk previously, so I'd like to have that amended.
Is there a second to that?
Madam Chairman, I saw that same thing and I was going to bring it up, but I couldn't remember whether he was there or not.
Is there a second to that?
I'll second that.
Any other corrections or changes? If not, I'll take a motion to approve them as amended.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor? 7-0. On to item number 32, to consider the acceptance of gifts given to the Thomas Memorial Library in memory of Gabriel A. Zimprich and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern.
Yes, thank you, Madam Chairman. This is one of those difficult issues, but one that shows some good can even come out of a tragic situation. Following the death of Gabriel Zimprich in early May, the family had suggested that donations be made to the Thomas Memorial Library in his memory. To date, over $12,000 has been given to the library in Gabe's memory, which really shows how much he was thought of, as well as how much the family as well is respected in this community and beyond. Because of the large sum that was donated, we began discussions with the Zimprich family as to the appropriate use of the funds. Initially, those discussions took place between Mr. and Mrs. Zimprich and George Rallis, and then later on directly between Mr. Zimprich and myself. What you have before you is a proposed declaration that would govern how the funds would be utilized. This dovetails very well with some plans that George and the trustees had developed earlier to help to develop a poetry collection at the Thomas Memorial Library, not only poetry, but also books on writing skills. It's proposed that the great majority of the funds go toward the development of a poetry collection that would be situated in what is now the main room, and that the main room collection would be placed outside of what is now the main room. This has been reviewed with the trustees, and they do find it very acceptable and a very forward step for the library. So I would recommend that you accept these funds and that you authorize me to sign the declaration on behalf of the community.
I so move.
Second.
Any discussion? No discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? 7-0. Item number 33, to consider reestablishing the Municipal Facilities Committee for the purpose of studying space needs for the police and fire departments and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern?
Yes, the Town Council had a workshop discussion of this earlier, late last month, confused with the times sometimes. This comes about as a result of a need that just doesn't go away, of needing to address what we're going to be doing with space long-term for our police, fire departments, our rescue, and our WET team. There's very close, very, very close surroundings over there for anyone that's been through those different buildings. And what we hope to do is to develop a long-term plan for the replacement of those facilities through establishing a new committee that takes over from a committee that was very well led and very well citizened about 5 years ago. It's proposed that there be a new Cape Elizabeth Public Safety Space Needs Review Committee with Irv Chappell continuing as the chairman, Gilly Jordan, Paula Liberty, Mike Maroon, Chuck Wilson continuing on the committee, and to have two additional citizens appointed by the town council chairman. The committee would review the existing space utilization of the various departments I mentioned, look at the comprehensive plan, the town center plan, the earlier report of the Municipal Facilities Committee, look at the zoning ordinance and everything that relates to the town center. They determine the long-range needs of the department and make sure that we're in compliance with various agencies that develop standards for the types of buildings we have here. If space needs are found to be deficient, the committee would review alternates for providing additional space with special consideration to reconfiguration of existing space uses and to the use of current municipal property. The committee would provide regular minutes to the council for your review as well as for public review, and it's suggested they present a final report to the town council at the earliest possible date, but no later than March 1. Any study properly done March 1 of this coming year. Any study properly done takes resources to do it, particularly when you're looking at the suitability of land for potential purposes. As the council's aware, as other options have come up over the last year or so, we have encumbered some funds in order to look at different options. That total now equals $6,702, including funds already paid, funds not yet paid, but that is the total encumbrance. I'm recommending a total of appropriation for this year, including some of those encumbered funds, of $11,000. This would make, that's from the overlay. The total budget in both years for all of the work for this study would be $12,031. I would recommend that you authorize the allocation of those funds from the overlay and that you establish the committee as indicated in the draft committee charge.
Comments? Discussion?
I have a couple things to say. First of all, I'd like to know how many times we need to study this issue. We studied it in 1990. They certainly did an excellent job, and I have no problem with bringing the committee back together with additional members to re-review the situation, but the situation hasn't changed. If anything, it's got worse in the last 5 years. I'm not certain that we need to keep studying the problem. I think we've studied it to death. We need the solutions. And I fully support bringing the committee back together, let them update the report, but I have a concern about continuing to spend money to have them tell us what we already know, and that is that we have a shortage of facilities. And so I would recommend that we reestablish the committee, let them take a look at the situation as it exists today, and then let us know if they think they need additional funds to continue to find some solution. But I don't know how many thousands of dollars we have to spend to have somebody tell us what we already know.
Mr. McGovern?
Yeah, I'd like to answer it in two ways. One is, you know, a number of issues come before this community that have a time lag in terms of when it was last looked at. Or there's a different group of people who are involved, particularly on the council. I can think of a recent issue. Oftentimes, if you haven't looked at five years at what your needs are, you know, and then you want to go ahead and do something, you leave yourself open to criticism that you haven't really done a current assessment of the need. I think everyone understands the need, but it's the specifics of then what ought to happen in the need. As for the funds, most of the funds are not going to be spent on the portion looking at the need. The funds are going to be spent looking at the specific alternatives. If you put a public safety building next door, for instance, or a police station where the gas station and service station is, you know, exactly, you know, how could that be configured on the land, analyzing the setbacks, analyzing construction costs, some of those issues, you know, everything short of design. You really need someone to do that other than just the volunteers on the committee. And, you know, a lot of those things haven't been done yet. So that's the reason for looking for funds as well as looking for, you know, I think it's overemphasizing to say that, you know, I know I've got it in the draft that we need to look at the need again. You know, in my mind, it's clear the need, but I'm not so sure that it's that the citizens truly understand the need and that it ought not to be documented in 1996.
Who are we trying to convince? I mean, are we trying to convince the citizens of the need? Is that what you're saying?
That's exactly what I'm saying. You know, too often in the past, you know, I'll be very specific. 2 months ago, the word was out on the street that this council was going to vote unanimously to do something. You know, the council did not do that. And, you know, a lot of the reason the council didn't do that, from what I understand, is that council has heard new information and they heard from the public. You know, this would be, again, getting information on need and assessment out to the public so the public as well can have meaningful input to the town council.
Well, I have no problem bringing the committee back together to have them update their previous review. I think that's a good idea. I support that. But I just can't support spending more money until we hear from them. If they come to us and say we need to spend some money to look at some option, that's fine. And I think we should address that when it comes up at the time, and see what their recommendations are. If we're going to have a citizens committee do something, I think we should hear from them.
You said that most of the money would be expended for investigating alternative designs. That's assuming they do verify that there is a need for space. How much money do you feel would be necessary to cover what was expended already and to give them a budget so that they can begin their work without getting into a lot of architectural configurations?
Exactly as my memo indicates.
Okay. But this is supposed to also cover some of those alternative proposals.
That's correct.
Okay. Councilor Jordan.
Just one question. So evidently, the previously money spent was never appropriated?
That's correct.
So this is to cover the cost of that appropriation and also any new work that needs to be done. And I'd like to hear from Councilor Chappell, if he would, being on the committee and chairing it, how he feels about the funds that is needed.
I've gone over this several times myself, and I've offered to be chairman of the committee, so I better not say too much because I'll be biting off my own nose here. But I remember back in 1990, Michael, when we did the Municipal Facilities Committee report, and the only thing we had to ask for at the end of it was enough money to print the report for the council. Everything else was done at no cost. And when you've got $56.71 that you spent already, I'm perfectly willing for that to be paid and get it off the books. But I don't know what I'd use $5,000 more for. Maybe you can tell me.
Yes, it is looking at the specific properties, developing schematics of what the different footprints of different buildings would be, taking the needs assessment that's developed and reviewed by the committee, laying out, you know, how different buildings would be designed inside. Before, when the committee met, you looked generally at overall need of like four or five different departments. It was a, you know, an assessment. I think John McGinty's point is correct. This whole purpose is to bring it beyond that step and not just to restudy it. It's hopefully at the end of this, there'll be something ready to go that then you would then be asked the funds to do the final design, eventually to put something out to bid, you know, be a judgment of the council when to do that. But to get to that point, we really need to know exactly where we're going to put one of these buildings, one or both, or to renovate. And we're just not ready to do that. I think the other point is you look at the previous committee, you had at least two architects on it who were volunteering their services. It's interesting, as this committee continues, the two people who are no longer serving on the committee are the two architects. You're left without the architects. I think it is a different situation than we had 5 years ago in terms of the depth of the study that needs to be done and in terms of the makeup of the committee. But the real point is the depth of what needs to be done. It's really trying to bring it along to satisfy Councilor McGinty's concerns that it's not just a study, that we end up with a good, realistic, publicly acceptable plan of what ought to happen.
Thank you.
Councilor Reed.
Madam Chairman, I would like to state that I was on the council in 1990 when the Municipal Facility Committee made their presentation. We accepted the report. And I have no problem voting tonight to allocate the $11,000 in this request. And if it would make Councilor McGinty a little less uneasy, then I would make a motion that says up to $11,000. But since it's only an appropriation, it's what's actually billed, Michael, right? We're asking to approve the expenditure, but I mean, it may only be $8,000. And I strongly support the idea that we know what the space needs are, we just have to pay for the professional fees that need to be done so that we can present this in some sort of legal and buildable manner. And I think that that's very important.
Councilor Lanau.
Thank you. Are we talking about basically around five or six thousand more on top of what's already been charged up, so to speak? And I guess what I'm if my understanding is correct, it seems to me that if it's spending, I hate to spend it, but if we're spending $5,000 to get some professional work on four or five different sites so that we have some objective criteria to evaluate the different proposals, it seems to me that in the Councillor McGinty's comments notwithstanding, that it seems to me that in the overall picture of what might come out of this, it seems to me it might be money well spent so that we avoid maybe a mere political decision. We really, if we can get some more objective information, I guess I'd tend to be in favor of it.
Do I have a motion on this item?
Maybe if I could answer Councilor Nell's question first. The additional amount is $4,298.
Okay.
That above what's been spent at this point.
Madam Chairman, I move that we reestablish the Municipal Facilities Committee for the purpose of studying space needs for the police and fire departments and authorize the allocation of funds from the overlay as proposed in the manager's memo.
Second.
Further discussion? Councilor Reed.
We also approving the draft charge?
Yes, we should be also doing that, too.
Yes, I'll include that in the motion.
Second.
Second, also.
Councilor McIntyre.
I just want to make it clear that I'm not opposed to establishing, reestablishing the committee. I think it's necessary. It's just I can't see expending further funds for information we already have.
Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you. Some of the information we don't have yet. The first three items I think we basically have. Those you can sit down. The first three items of the charge you can sit down and cover in a day if your staff has the material prepared. Reviewing the alternative sites we don't have. We did not have an ownership situation of the property next door the last time we studied this. That's different now. Some of the information has not been specifically looked at with everything that we need to know. I have found this council has been loath lately to spend money to get good, hard information on which to base its decisions. I'm not a great one who loves spending money. Some of it we've looked at, but not with that committee taking a focused look at everything and all the alternatives, comparing apples to apples. And I think it's appropriate to do that now. I think the bigger question is going to be, is there going to be the political will to go ahead and do the construction? This is going to be a drop in the bucket, and we need to know what road we're going down when we get started.
Councilor Jordan.
Well, I'd just like to add, I'm opposed at first to the money that was involved here because I felt that they were going to review what had already been done. But in listening, I think the conversations that's gone around here has been good. And I feel now we're going to come out with some details and sketches and pictures that you can look at to know why this building won't go there and that building will go here and things like that. If that's what we're going to get, I'm in favor of it.
Other comments? If not, those in favor of the motion? Those opposed? 6-1. Item number 34. To consider authorizing funds for the town share of the town center sidewalk storm drainage project and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern.
Yes, thank you, Madam Chairman. It's one of those evenings that we're trying to tie up some loose ends of issues that have been around for some period. This is to authorize design of the town center sidewalk drainage project. The grant application was first approved by the town council about 2 years ago, originally as a $410,000 project. MDOT this past winter did an extensive survey, of which they're asking us to pick up a small portion of the cost. They really did a good job looking at the drainage patterns in the area, as well as looking at all of the existing structures in terms of curbing and signage and buildings and all those type things. It's proposed that the project begin down at the intersection of Farm Hill Road. It picks up just that very small section in front of Mrs. Johnson's house along Route 77. Along Scott Dyer Road. It continues up Scott Dyer Road to the Route 77 intersection, and then down as far as the high school driveway. Funds permitting, it would also jump across the street and go from Key Bank to the town hall. I am suggesting that we request PACS and MDOT to fund the project at a $440,000 level. They will pick up 85% of the cost, the federal and state governments. We would be required to pick up 15% of the cost. As you've heard in the past, under the school approval process, we already have to replace the sidewalk all along Scott Dyer Road in front of the school project. And if we didn't go ahead with this project, we'd be doing that at essentially 100% of our cost. So what we're really doing is getting the rest of this project paid for with the federal and state funds without really any additional local contribution or a very small one when you look at the larger picture. The letter from MDOT does indicate that they would like to deduct shade trees out of the project. That's not acceptable, obviously. The intent is to maintain the trees. My recommendation back to MDOT, if you're willing to go ahead, would be that they set up the actual bid when they do this on an alternate deduct system, whereby, you know, if there'll only be X number of funds available, and if necessary, what section would be pushed back or brought back in order to stay within the existing funds. This would provide for curbing, it would provide for an esplanade, it would provide for trees, and it would provide almost as important as everything else for some drainage improvements here in the town center. We're dumping water onto the lot next door without any permission, which is going to need to be addressed at some point. We also may be a contributing factor to a high water problem down at the shopping center. So it would be very positive for us to address our drainage issues at the same time. Let me just summarize the local share of the $440,000 budgeted level would be $66,000. This is with the federal government picking up 80% and the state 5%. So I would ask that you authorize me to negotiate a design agreement with the state of Maine, Maine Department of Transportation, for a $440,000 project, and that you allocate $66,000 out of the existing appropriation for roadway and drainage improvements. This is not new money that's being asked for. It was in the budget. You simply did not formally approve it in the budget and said, let's set that aside, we'll look at it later. And this is through your previous workshop, and tonight this is the looking at it later. Thank you.
Comments from anyone? Councilor, right. No?
Well, I think anytime you, if you spend a dollar, if you can get a contribution of four more, I think it's something to take a good look at. And it seems to me that this would solve a number of problems. It would certainly help straighten out the situation near the school and take care of a handful of stormwater and so forth issues. So I think we ought to, I would tend to support it.
Is that a motion?
Yeah, there's a motion, support. To authorize towns for the authorize funds for the town's share of the town center sidewalk storm drainage project.
And to
which one?
To take any necessary action.
Which project?
I'm sorry?
Which project?
Down, as the manager described.
We got number one, number two,
go two,
and number three.
Two was the one he was
talking. I didn't hear him say two, I'm sorry.
Two.
Okay.
I'll second that if that's a motion.
Okay. Councilor Reed.
Aren't we supposed to also authorize the town manager to negotiate with MDOT?
That's correct.
Sure. I can amend it.
Okay. And the second amends.
Well, I have another sentence to my...
I'm sorry.
Well, no, I just...
Too long a breath.
No, I just... I just think that it would be important for the public to know just exactly where we're talking about, and I would like to see in the motion that it includes provide improvements along Scott Dyer Road from Farm Hill to Route 77 and along Route 77 from Scott Dyer to the high school, and funds permitting to include the opposite side of Route 77 from KeyBank to the town hall, just for the public record so that people would be able to see that.
I would have a problem seconding that. I'm concerned with the way, I think I heard the manager, you didn't propose anything that was going to contradict that. If we're asking them, say, we're saying we have this fixed amount of money, how long a linear stretch can you do? Is it possible some of that, besides from Town Hall to KeyBank, could not be done?
No, what the council is being asked to do this evening is to authorize design.
Okay.
It's not actual construction. That would come in the construction phase. Also, if you look at the numbers of estimated design, it doesn't vary very much from one to another, so I'm going to be pushing them to design as much as possible with the understanding that we would only bid out, you know, that which could be afforded.
I'll second the amendment.
Councilor Jordan.
I would just like to, I know there's estimated figures, but I don't know what we're going to have for lighting, but as I read these figures, the lighting, $113,000, is more than the drainage system, and a few things like that, so I guess I'll have to wait till it comes back after they design it. But I was hoping that there wasn't going to be a pole every 100 feet or so. Nice, slow ones, I don't think that we need, like, something like that.
Other comments? Mr. McGovern, it was my understanding during our discussion of this item in a workshop setting that we were also going to ask MDOT during the design phase to bring back their preliminary design to us for comments before they presented a completed design. And at that phase, we also wanted to pass on that preliminary design to the P2 committee just for their comments. Is that correct?
Yes, and MDOT is aware of that through meetings we've had with them.
Okay, I just wanted to make sure that everyone else knew that too. Any other discussion? Those in favor of the motion as amended, that is a 7-0. Item number 35, to consider authorizing funds for the construction of a base for the Cape Elizabeth Light Lens to be placed in the Town Hall lobby and take any necessary action. There was an addendum. Did you all receive this in a later packet as to a change in the bid amount? It's on a different color paper. Mr. McGovern.
Yes, thank you, Madam Chairman. As everyone is aware, the Coast Guard is loaning to the town a very significant resource for the heritage of Cape Elizabeth, that being the lens that has been up in the Two Lights Lighthouse Tower for many, many years. I'm not too sure the exact number of years, but it was recently taken down from the tower because of some issues involving the pool of mercury that it was resting in. The mercury is all safely removed. We don't need to worry about that. But the Coast Guard was willing to give it to the town through a loan agreement that was previously approved by the town council. This is, again, a little bit of housekeeping in terms of the council agreed that where we'd display it, how it would be displayed, and no funds were ever appropriated for that purpose. We did go out to bid with the original design. The low bid came in at $6,900. We indicated that this is a very, very valuable treasure. However, we have other things we'd like to spend money on, and we'd like to relook at the design and try to knock the cost down quite a bit. The architect for us, Bob Howe, has been negotiating with the low bidder and has changed the design, which would bring the cost down to $4,355. This includes a major change. It was due to be tied into the walls totally. Now it will be on a round platform that will rest in the corner, but that will not be tied into the walls, which is a difference that is positive in two respects. One, it saves a lot of money, but two, it also that if we ever did want to move it someplace else, we don't have the problem that had been tied into the walls. We also reduced the electrical aspects of it somewhat. It is still going to have the availability of a light on the inside, controlled by a dimmer switch, as well as one overhead light, whereas three had been in the original design. That's all fairly good news. The best news is that Cheryl Milligan is here tonight, and things are going wonderfully at the museum at Portland Headlight. The gift shop is very, very busy. Sales are up 25% this month. They're up 36% last month. This is part of the collection of the museum at Portland Headlight, and she was very wise to suggest that these funds really ought to come out of the Lighthouse Fund and not out of the town's general fund, so that since it is part of the collection, it would come out of that fund. We're really doing terrific down there, thanks to Cheryl's hard work and the dedication of so many volunteers. The one other point I would like to mention is that the ongoing cost of it in terms of insurance will also be paid by the Portland Headlight Fund. So I would recommend you authorize the $4,355 from the Portland Head Lighthouse Fund.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. There being no discussion, all those in favor? It's a 7-0. Thank you, Cheryl. Item number 36, to consider a proposed policy for placement of children playing signs and take any necessary action. We also have the head of our Public Works Department, Bob Malley, present. Mr. McGovern, do you want to give us some background?
Yes. As you can see, I've had this memo since May 5th of 1995. That is indicative of my feelings about this particular issue. I really appreciate Bob's putting it forward, and I think it is an important issue. He does refer to it as informal guidelines. We've had informal guidelines. What's now being proposed is that we actually have a policy, a formal policy, of where we put children playing signs and where we do not put them. We receive an amazing number of calls from folks wanting to have these signs placed. Folks call all the time. We generally advise them that we don't feel that they do any good, but yet it does give people comfort, and it's one of those issues for the few that it might affect positively. You know, it's difficult if you, you know, said you're not going to put it in and then something happens, why wasn't it put in? But, you know, I quite frankly do have to question the utility of these signs other than making people feel good. You know, I hope that at some point that it might save a kid from being injured, but I really can't say from my own observation that it really does that much good. The specific proposal provides that we would place a children playing sign into the entrance of any approved subdivision, and that it only be at the entrance of the subdivision, that we not put signs throughout the subdivision. That they would not be installed under Bob's proposal on arterial collector or rural connector classified roads unless he and I both agree to that. You know, that we're not going to sprinkle them every 1,000 feet. That we'd put them on local classified roads within approved subdivisions as posted. That's just really concludes it there. So I would, you know, suggest that you approve this policy. It's not something I do strongly or feel strongly about, but I think the absence of a policy leaves the staff in a very awkward position of when to say yes and when to say no. You know, once in a while we'll say no, and people say, I want a copy of the policy, and our response is, well, we don't have a copy of a policy. The council's never formally enacted one. And our preference would be for you to either adopt this policy or, you know, if it was your choosing to essentially say, don't put them out, because otherwise it becomes a very awkward situation. Thank you. Ringing endorsement.
And also the chief of police commented that he agreed with your and Mr. Malley's comments. Comments from the council.
I have one question. Is Mitchell Road a collector road? Is that right?
Mr. Lanau.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Sounds like a good idea to me. Thank you.
Is that a motion?
Yeah. I would move that we adopt the proposed policy for the placement of children playing signs.
Second.
Discussion. Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. I'm not going to support this. I talked with the police chief about the situation. This is not something that's enforceable. It's a cautionary sign, and I I heard the manager talk about it giving comfort to some people. I think that's very false comfort. There's been one of these signs in my neighborhood, I think, for the 21 years that I've lived there. It doesn't necessarily slow the cars down. I think if people want to put up their own creation of a sign, which I have seen one or two around town, I think those are the ones you remember and pay attention to. Those wouldn't be enforceable either, but I think you pay more attention to them. I think they would do the job better. I would be very comfortable saying to staff, just say no, and I'm not going to support the motion.
Yes, Councillor Jordan.
Well, I don't know if it'll care. I agree that it's not going to carry too much weight, but it, to me, you've done something to where the people and children be playing. I'm not in favor of homemade signs because I can picture that it wouldn't be too far down the road. There'd be some homemade ones that you wouldn't care for. So I guess you got to do it yourself because people can come up with some creative ways of letting you know that something is ahead. And I think at this point that I will support the sign deal and hope that it doesn't get too many signs put up around, because I remember a few years ago we was having quite a time because we had too damn many signs around Cape Elizabeth. Now I'm in the process of agreeing that maybe other signs, but I think some people do look at them and realize that there's children around, and I think we should work in that direction if we can help. I know, like the memo says, and I agree with it 100%, people that live there will ignore them, but the others that come in would read the sign and recognize them.
Other comments? Mr. McGinty.
Madam Chair, I would prefer not to have a established policies such as this. I prefer to have the Director of Public Works, the police chief, and the town manager sit down on each individual situation to review all aspects, the conditions, road conditions, the speed of the road, all that type of thing, the enforceability of the speed limit in those neighborhoods, and make individual decisions on each individual case, as opposed to lay down a policy that says, no, we can't have one on a collector road. Where there may be real good cause to have one at some particular location because of the characteristics of the road, or you know, adjacent numbers of kids or something like that. So again, I prefer to have them dealt on an individual basis as opposed to have a written policy.
Am I correct, Councillor Linnell, in your motion you only dealt with the first two reasons that things would be installed, or were you also did you also intend to include where they would not be installed with the two steps that were listed below? Because in that second section it does give authorization to the Director of Public Works and the town manager to put them on these other roads if they deem the situation warrants it.
I think that makes sense. I would like to leave some. I would like the Director of Public Works and the town manager to have that discretion.
Was not his motion just the first two?
I thought it was a policy. As
the whole policy.
The whole policy.
Okay.
Yeah.
Good. I just wanted to clarify that. So you did intend the entire policy with the four different.
Right. Right. And if I may just editorialize.
Yes.
Again, I think it's a reasonable compromise. It doesn't sprinkle them all over town. It puts them at the outside of development, or subdivision, I should say. So I think it's a reasonable compromise, and if they see a need for other signs, the town manager and the public works director can put them there. And I know it may not be enforceable, but I don't think we need to. Enforcement isn't the answer to everything. I think it's just a reminder, and we'll never know if it does some good. But I, as long as we're not putting them up every 50 feet, I think it's reasonable.
Councillor Chappell.
I have a problem with this making this a policy. I think it's the town manager and the chief and the highway commissioner are hiding behind a policy that the council makes. I think that this should be individual. I know if I was in an area and I had two or three neighbors and myself that I was all concerned, and I asked for a children playing sign and I couldn't get it because of some policy, I'd be really concerned, and I'd put up quite a battle here at some evening that they pass something which I don't think it needs a policy, because the sign actually is no good anyway. It's not, but why should we take something that the citizen might like and just say no, flat no? I'd rather have him come to the town office, sit down for 5 minutes with the manager and saying, we'll look at yours, the chief will, and they will, and we'll let you know. A phone call, we've decided no, covers the whole thing. But a policy, I don't think I like it.
Actually, if I understand what was presented tonight, that option is there. They do have to go to these individuals. They will not be automatically installed. They have to be reviewed. Is that the way I'm reading this policy? So that your concern, Mr. McGinty, and yours, Mr. Chappell, should be addressed here, but they will have to go that extra step, and they do have something in black and white for people to follow.
Madam Chair.
Councillor.
That begs the question, why do we need a policy if it's going to be the policy that they're going to review each of these on an individual basis? If they can review anyone anyway, why do we have a policy? If they have to review everyone anyway, why do we need a policy?
They don't have to do it. It's only in certain situations. Yes, Mr. McGovern.
Let me briefly respond to that. Staff gets into an awkward position because the council is the policy-making body. People ask, what is the policy? And, you know, if the policy is that we can make the judgment, that's fine. But at least then you've given some policy direction. Because otherwise, we get into this, it's just an awkward situation. Otherwise, absent of a policy, you know, you could have, any time we make a decision, folks would be coming into the council meeting, you know, lining up saying they want signs. This would delegate that responsibility clearly. You know, if we took your alternative, Councilor McGinty, to the staff, and that would be fine. That would be the policy. But at that point, we'd have policy direction. It's the staff's responsibility to deal with it. That would be the message.
Councilor Reid.
I have a question regarding the difference between a policy and an administrative guideline.
Yeah.
Could we make this an administrative guideline instead of a policy?
Calling a dog a cat doesn't make it.
Well, a policy is that the town council says these things happen in these four items. To me, an administrative guideline is this is the recommendation of the council to follow, from the council, oh, I'm so sorry, for the town council to follow when staff makes a decision based on the individual circumstances of the case. So if we could downgrade, if you will, this from a policy to administrative guideline, no, doesn't matter?
Okay. Not really. Any other comments? If not, I'll move the motion. Councilor Jordan.
No, I think it's right back on the council. The council is a policy-making body here within the town, and to me, this is a policy that I, for one, would like to see followed, and I'll leave it up to the manager and the chief and the public works director to make the decision as far as where one should go and one shouldn't. And if I don't like it or I get too many calls, I'll let them know about it.
All those in favor of the motion as presented?
In favor
of the motion, yes. All those opposed? 3-4. Well, you still don't have anything in writing. Sorry, guys.
I knew I left that off the agenda for a while for a purpose.
Item number 37. To consider proposed parking restrictions near the intersection of Bowery Beach Road and Ocean House Road and take any necessary action.
Yes.
Councillor, you've been promoted.
Don't demote him.
He's been demoted salary-wise, but Mr. McGovern.
Yes, the area that this is talking about is the triangle that surrounds the ice cream stand down at the corner of Bowery Beach Road, Route 77, Ocean House Road. there's been a growing parking problem situation, particularly as you're looking at the ice cream stand from Route 77 on that little section of road that is on the right. It's an unnamed piece of road near as I can figure, looking at our records. What has happened is, in many times, from my own observation, is the parking lot at the ice cream stand will be mostly empty. People just pull up to the side there, jump out of their car, jump into the ice cream line, and they park on both sides, going in opposite directions. I've witnessed little ones, you know, when they park over in front of the homes over there, Clow's home, and I forget the name of the other person. And you've also got all the traffic coming out of the Kettle Cove area and down through there. So it's a real messy situation. I've spoken to the owner of the ice cream stand, met with him when another resident called to complain from down that vicinity. He thought parking was already banned in the area that's proposed to be banned. And when I looked at the policy, what it actually says is that we ban parking there during the day, which was to try to get away from having people park there along that road and then walk to the beach. Even though the complaint was only on the right side, this proposal also would ban parking on the left side because of the concern that if you banned it on the right side, the problem just might move to the left side. And that really would block the sight distance in the intersection. Besides, you got a lot of driveways there, it'd be awkward to park there anyway. So it's for ease of clarity and organization, it has both. But anyway, what the proposal is from 9 a.m. to 6 p.m. from May 1 to October 1, no vehicle shall be parked on either side of Ocean House Road from Crescent View Avenue easterly to a point 150 feet northerly of the Ocean House Road, Pheasant Road intersection. That is already in the policy. The addition would be there shall be no parking at any time from May 1 to October 1 from the intersection of Crescent View Avenue and Ocean House Road westerly to both sections of Ocean House Road with Bowery Beach Road, which takes in the two fingers from Crescent View up. So sometimes you send this to the Ordinance Committee, sometimes you send it to public hearing. I would defer to the wishes of the council.
Madam Chairman, I move that we send the proposal to public hearing at the September
11th.
Whatever meeting?
11th
meeting, 7:30 Town Hall Chambers.
Second it.
Town Council Chambers.
Discussion. I know at one time we discussed the possibility of closing that other little connector road and just leaving part of the area open for access off 77 to that one driveway to help reduce some of the congestion, and that would allow for additional parking that would not actually be in a highway. I know we had talked to the chief and the director of public works, and they seemed to think, other than for slight legal complications which you felt might arise, that it would overall be a better policy. Perhaps we should look at that again. But in the meantime, we can implement this type of parking ban.
I might add one. I agree. We will look at that. In the meantime, maybe that's something at the public hearing we could elicit some comments upon. In the meantime, we do have emergency no parking signs there that have been authorized by the chief and I in conformance with another section of this ordinance, because it did look so unsafe.
Okay. Other comments? Councilor Reed.
I had a question. How would this be signed permanently?
We would put signposts up on April 30th. Would we do that here too? I presume so. And we would take them back down on October 5th, and it would say no parking May 1 to October 1.
Thank you.
Councilor Jordan.
I agree with that, and I think we should move forward with it, so I will vote in favor of this.
All those in favor of setting this for public hearing September 11th at 7:30 here in the town hall? 7-0, public hearing. Number 38, to consider a request from the town manager to fund improvements to the sewer lines in the vicinity of the Cape Elizabeth Middle School from the sewer fund balance and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern?
Yes, when the school project was being planned, we reminded the school department that we had a real problem with the sewer line that extended from the middle school over to Farm Hill Road under someone's garage and then into Farm Hill Road into a very small sewer line that was built during the Second World War. That sewer line, we've had lots of problems with backups in that area. It's beginning to get old. We're beginning to need to think about replacing it. But we thought it, as an interim measure for long-term improvements, it'd be best to have all of the school system avoid sewer, avoid that residential street, and instead go right down into the sewer down by the high school. As a result of the school project, they invested significant amount of funds improving the sewer lines down to that area. However, when they were given all the plans, there was a sewer line that wasn't shown that was up under, coming down from the 1930s building down into the rest of the system. You know, they were willing to do this. They were even willing to do this in addition to everything else that they did. However, you know, the 19-5 at this point really puts a crimp on where they stand with the overall budget. The school budget, you know, the city of Portland, we all know, is discussing $1.7 million, whatever the amount is tonight. We're very fortunate. Our school project is almost exactly on budget. It's really a miracle of the modern age that it's gone so well and that the project's going really as good as it is. So anyway, this unexpected $19,500 bill came up. Since they were doing this as a favor to us to begin with, that really didn't have anything to do with the project. It was just something we said, while you're at it, will you do it for us? I felt it was appropriate that now that it was more than they bargained for when they agreed to do it, that this come out of the sewer fund, the $19,500 change order, instead of the school project. This would come out of the sewer line maintenance account if you approve this per my recommendation.
Councilor Reed.
Michael, in addition to a miracle, I'll also add probably the diligence of the school building committee has caused that to be right on budget and ahead of schedule. And I would make a motion that we authorize the expenditure of $19,500 from the sewer line maintenance account to pay for the additional costs incurred to relocate the sewer line as requested by the town.
Second.
Discussion. Councilor Jordan.
I'm just lost on where they're going to pick this line up. I guess it don't matter to me as long as it runs downhill to the plant, but I'm just interested in the old line used to come out through the ball field and what have you, I believe. And that parking lot where they built around, I'm just interested in where it's headed, do you know?
The old line used to run over across the middle school field.
Yes.
Under the garage to Farm Hill Road.
That's right.
The new line goes all the way down through across the soccer lacrosse fields down into the interceptor that's down below the tennis courts. So it goes into that line that comes over from Broad Cove and Shore Acres and my neighborhood.
So I understand all that, but so they're still hooking into the line that's coming out across the field and then go down towards.
That's right, and then going down. Yeah, this was actually had to be tunneled under a wing of the middle school in order to accomplish it.
That's right.
And the work is done. The is already done. And if the council didn't authorize this, it would come out of the school project.
Further discussion? There being none, all those in favor of the motion is presented. 7-0. They add that to the 95,000 surplus.
This stays in the
contingency fund.
Stays, yeah. The contingency fund. Thank you for asking that, or mentioning it. The contingency fund right now has $95,000 in it. That is really, really tight. That sounds like a lot of money, but an awful lot of things that the building committee has been asked to do over the last year, they've put off, saying, we've got to be absolutely sure that we don't run out of money before there's something we absolutely have to do. So that $95,000 could disappear very, very quickly with some roof surprises that they've already found on top of the old middle school. Those two little peaks that come up are parapets, thank you, or leaning over, and they do plan to address those. But it, the $95,000 plus this $19,500 will, you know, enable them to continue to look over the next month at what needs to be done, as well as to look back at some of the things they really would have liked to have done and couldn't, such as, you know, the tiles in the elementary school bathrooms that were never replaced, that, you know, look way out of place, and there's a number of other issues as well.
Councillor, Mr. McGovern asked that we have an addendum, item number 39, which deals with a loan agreement between the town of Cape Elizabeth and Shaw Sprague with the loan of lenses, lighthouse lenses, and take any necessary action. He has a copy before him. I don't believe he's passed it on to us.
Yes.
Yes, he has.
He didn't pass it on to me. Okay.
Oh, well. You were busy.
I guess. I'm too far away. If you would like to give us some more background information on this.
Yes. Back when the museum at Portland Headlight was being developed and researched, one of the project staffers was a woman by the name of Chris Mathen.
Excuse me.
Oh,
we need to have a motion to take an item out of order.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor? Six. Opposed?
Awake.
Irv? You're opposed?
Yeah.
Okay. 6-1.
Yes. One of the staff members involved in it was Chris Mathen, who was looking at some of the different lenses, their history, and looking at developing the collection. During that process, it was discovered that a fourth-order lens that is believed to have come from Portland Headlight, it's certainly identical to the fourth-order lens that was at the Portland Headlight Tower, was located and owned by Shaw Sprague, a resident of Cape Elizabeth. Henry Adams at that time, as well as the project architects, approached an employee of Mr. Sprague's, the caretaker of the property, about whether or not Mr. Sprague might be willing to loan that to the museum. The response at that time was not positive. I think it, you know, sort of took him by surprise. Since that time, Mr. Sprague has sold his major parcel in Cape Elizabeth, where the particular lens was displayed, and it's been in storage. Henry Adams spoke to the caretaker again about 2 months ago about it, and got a call very recently from the caretaker indicating that Mr. Sprague was now willing to not only loan that lens to the town, but an additional lens. The lens would come to the town. It would not be on permanent loan. It would be on a loan that could be recalled essentially at any point. This provides that it could only be recalled with 7 days' notice to the town. We could also break the agreement on our end with 30-day notice. Say we wanted to send the lens back for whatever reason. The insurance costs suddenly went out of sight or some such issue. We could break the agreement as well. The fourth order lens, we do have a location to display it within the museum that would not cost money to modify. It's an existing platform that would handle the lens. Our cost for this would be the cost of insurance. That would come out of the Portland Headlight Museum Fund. It's approximately $127 per year for insurance. That's insuring each lens for $25,000 or a total of $50,000. It would not be required that we would have to have the lens on display. We could have them in either storage or display. And there would be a sign on the lens or a side it indicating that would be on loan from a private collection. The particular name of the private collector would not be indicated at the museum. That's an outline of this. Again, the cost to the town would be $127. However, if we kept it for an extended period, i.e. over 2 years, which we would fully expect, we might run into some costs when it was returned to recrate it so that it could be shipped to its final destination.
Comments from the council? Councillor Reed.
I'll make a motion that we approve the loan agreement between the Town of Cape Elizabeth and Shaw Sprague for the loan of 2 lighthouse lenses.
Second. Discussion. I guess
sounds good to me.
This $127 a year is for both lenses or per lens?
For both.
Do you want more time to think about this? I mean, this is something, Councillor Leno.
Well, I think we could go ahead with it. I would just underscore that if they, the nature of contracts is such that if that it's a two-way street and it may be recalled with 7 days' notice, and the town has the same right. If we decide we want to do something different, we can. We need only give 7 days' notice, essentially.
No, we have 30 days to.
I'm sorry, 30. Well, whatever.
Was the 7 days our idea or the owner's idea?
No, that was. I have not discussed that particular period of days with him. I just had indicated. That discussion was that he could recall it at any time. That was the discussion that Henry has had with the caretaker. I didn't, you know, I looked to see what we would need to do if it disappeared. You know, we would need a few days to, you know, make sure someone was available to do it and whatever. And I figured 7 would more than cover it, but you know, it could be 30. It's the point that you know, we don't want anyone, you know, representing Mr. Sprague, a future heir or whatever, to come and say, I want it this minute. That's not the way it would work. That, you know, there'd have to be a period of notice. 30 days would be just as fine as 7.
I think we should be treated equally. Councillor Jordan.
I would just like to say that it's $25,000 insurance on each lens, right? And where would they be located? You got room for them?
Yes, the fourth order for an L lens would be on public display at the museum. The other lens, you know, I'd rather not publicly state where it might be at any given point. But it would be, you know, on secure municipal property.
That takes care of my next question.
It could be on display, but when it's not when it's not on display, it would be in secure municipal property. It's not coming to the town hall, believe me. Not on public display.
Councillor Linnell.
So I guess from our discussion a few moments ago, it seems to me prudent to that we would change this 7 days to 30 days notice.
Who made the original motion? Councillor Reed?
I don't agree with that.
I don't either.
I think 7 is plenty, and I think it's very generous for the loan. So I'll retract my motion and make a new one. I don't think it's necessary to have 30 days, 30 days. I think 7 and 30 is, I'm very comfortable with it.
I seconded the motion. I'm also comfortable with that. You can amend it and take a vote on the amendment.
Madam Chairman.
Councilor Leno.
I just think that the 7 days is really lends itself to sort of a capricious decision. And I just think if anyone wants to make a decision like that, I think they ought to. 30 days is reasonable. And I think it should be the same. And I think 30 days, I think it ought to read 30 days. 7 days is awful quick. I mean, it just.
Particularly since we're closed part of the time and our director is not always available.
Yeah.
I think it would be more doable.
Yeah, and I think, you know, some people will attend our.
Do you want to amend the motion to change it to 30 days for both parties in terminating the lease?
That would be, yes.
You're making a motion to?
To amend it, to amend, to change it to 30 days. And if I may editorialize for a second.
Well, let's have a second for that first. Is there a second on that amendment? That the town would all, that they would have to give the town 30 days notice as well? I'll second it. You want to editorialize?
Yes, please. I am aware of the, just human nature is such that sometimes people make these decisions, and I think 30 days is reasonable for anything. Whether, and I don't know as we ought to take it. If we can't have 30 days notice to take it back, I guess I wouldn't be in favor of taking it at all.
Councilor McGinty.
Madam Chair, I don't think it's an issue. I agree that we should welcome the fact that they want to donate this for display, and if it's one day, who cares? You know, they got to come down, pack it up, let them come down, pack it up.
No, that would be our responsibility. That's the problem.
Not in the first two years.
2 years.
So, I don't think it's an issue. I'd move the question.
All those in favor of the amendment of allowing both parties 30-day option for canceling the contract?
Who seconded the amendment?
I did.
Chair did.
Oh, you did, didn't you? Sorry.
All those in favor?
All those opposed? 5-2. So it's a 2-5 amendment. Back to the original motion that we accept this loan agreement as a convenience to Mr. Sprague to store his two lighthouse lenses for him.
I don't believe that's was worded, Madam Chairman.
I didn't make that motion.
For the loan agreement between the town and Sprague. All those in favor?
As printed.
All those opposed? 5-2. It is a convenience. On to a citizen discussion of items not on the agenda.
Move with you.
There being none, I'll take a motion for adjournment.
So moved.
So moved.
No second.
All those in favor? 7-0.
Don't get any arguments on that.
Just think of that at 9 o'clock.
Good night, one and all. We're going off the air.
I hope so.
Okay.